This is Burlington, and I'm pleased to continue our ongoing nuclear-free future conversation here in the Channel 17 studio. And my name is Margaret Harrington, and with our viewers, I'm pleased to welcome Maggie Gunderson, who is the president of Fairwinds Energy Education, and Arne Gunderson, who is the chief engineer of Fairwinds Energy Education. And these are very interesting times, to say the least, in this atomic information age that we're living in. And you bring things together, it seems to me, on your website, Fairwinds and Energy Education, where you're giving us information and updating us on the events of our time. And Maggie, could you start by telling us exactly what is the mission of Fairwinds Energy Education?
Well, Fairwinds Energy Education, and first off, Margaret, thank you for having us on the show very much.
Thank you for being here. So,
and we both appreciate the invitation. Fairwinds Energy Education is a 501c3 nonprofit organization that its mission is to educate the public on nuclear power issues, nuclear safety, nuclear reliability, and to take the jargon that the nuclear industry creates and use simple language to explain what's going on. We've done a number of videos in which Arne has done some experiments and showed very easily what's really happening at different nuclear plants around the country and overseas.
That's very important because I, as a member of the general public, am confused and dismayed by the lack of information and truth-telling about what is going on. We are almost into the full year after the March 11th triple meltdown of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant. And it's really shocking that we are left in the dark, that we are given a lot of misinformation about this. And so that the value of your service is very important right now. So we're going to show a video at the end of our conversation, one of your most recent ones. And today, I read that the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency from the UN, is going over to Japan to what, Arne? How could you explain what they are going to do?
Well, you were mentioning the jargon, and it's like there's a nuclear priesthood, and that's been a term that's been out there for about 50 years, and they're trying to control the jargon and make it appear like it's too hard for the rest of us to understand. And really what we've been able to do on the site is show that jargon is just that, but there's real information in there that's being, the public is not receiving. So the IAEA you'll see press reports saying that they're a UN watchdog agency. But their own charter says that their role is to promote nuclear power. So they're not a watchdog at all. They're a promotional branch of the nuclear power industry.
Let me see. That reminds me of another agency here in the United States, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Wasn't their original mission to promote nuclear power?
Under the Atomic Energy Commission, AEC.
Yes.
And under President Ford, the agency was split, and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission was formed in order to have regulation in place and have a stronger regulator and not a promoter. And the DOE is there to be the promoter. But all they did was change the sign over the door, and the same people were still there. So they continued all the same policies.
So it's very important to see the correlation between these two agencies.
Yeah, in the U.S. we have the NRC has been captured. There's actually a term called regulatory capture, and the over the years they've had more and more constraints placed upon them by Congress and the nuclear industry. So they're really, certainly not a watchdog agency anymore, if they ever were. But it's interesting in Japan. They never made that transition. Their regulator and the industry were controlled by the same agency. They actually, the nuclear regulator reported to the, called METI, and it's a group responsible for promoting industry within Japan. So Japan didn't even take that first step. I mean, we did, but then the NRC never really bought it anyway. And the IAEA never even acknowledged there was that they had a safety function. Immediately after the accident, the chairman of the IAEA said, no, we're not a watchdog. We are not a watchdog. So they're on record as saying that. But yet now they're going to Japan, and the press is portraying it as if they are a watchdog. And it's just not the case. It's not in their charter to look out for nuclear safety.
And their mission there is to reopen the nuclear power reactors?
Well, they're opening an office, which is a bad sign. It's the only office they've ever opened. But their
outside
mission...
Outside of Vienna, yeah.
Yeah, they have their main office in Vienna, but this is a branch office. And the Japanese government is suggesting that they're going to listen to the IAEA and do whatever the IAEA says. But again, you get to the point of saying they've been, it's not in their charter to make safety regulations. They just don't do it.
This is very disturbing. And the thing is that the IAEA is also the so-called watchdog group that has gone into Iran to check to see if they're working on nuclear power reactors or nuclear bombs. Isn't that so?
The agency has two charters. On the bomb side, 92% of their staff works on bomb. 8% of their staff works on nuclear reactor oversight. And so when they look at proliferation issues, they actually have teeth. The NRC charter for proliferation is relatively strong. The IAEA charter for nuclear power is weak. It's, we are going to promote nuclear power. So they actually have a split in the organization. 92% in favor of working on proliferation issues, and only 8% working on nuclear power.
And now in Japan, there are only a few nuclear power reactors in use, correct?
There's only three that remain running. They had 54, 10 were knocked out because of the tsunami. The four at Fukushima Daiichi and the four at Fukushima Daini. And they probably will never start back up. And then they had another six that were located right on an active fault. And those six will probably never start back up. So 16 of their 54 will probably never start back up. And then all of the others have been shut down. And in Japan, the town needs to approve the startup. And none of the towns want these things started back up. So when a plant shuts down, it can't start back up without approval of the town. The three remaining plants will shut down by April, and they'll have no nuclear power plants operating.
And that's been a big controversy because the industry then went out, METI is the Ministry of Energy and Technology, and they went out and started saying, oh, this is terrible. Without nuclear power, we're not going to have any air conditioning in the summer. People are going to be sick. They're going to die. It's going to be too hot. And actually, they have a 6% surplus of power when you consider renewable sources that they have, when you consider water and wind and solar. And so they do have plenty of power. And this was an effort by the promoters of the nuclear industry to try and scare people in these towns and cities to approve the plants restarting. And the NAIS, the nuclear, what is it?
It's their
supposedly their regulator, nuclear agency. I can't remember what the acronym stands for, but NAIS went ahead and actually seated people in the meetings in these towns to get them to cheer for reopening the towns and try and swing the vote. And there's a lot of really uncomfortable clashes between peoples in their communities. And there's a high level of tension.
And isn't it true that there are also citizens groups that have started up because of the distrust of the government and of the nuclear industry.
Right,
there.
And that's very unusual in Japan. They've never had anything like this.
Yeah. It's always been noted as a conformist society, right?
Correct.
With everybody agrees and they don't want to step forward to make any kind of scene. But this completely goes against that image.
Yes. The anti-nuclear movement is probably about 20% of the population now. And in Japan, that's an enormous number. People are confronting their public officials and hollering at them to let them into meetings. There was a meeting last week where the public showed up. They actually were, they had done all of the appropriate things to get into the meeting. And when the organizers of the meeting, this was a nuclear startup meeting, I believe, when the organizers of the meeting discovered there were so many people from the public there, they said, oh, we can't have you here. We need to move you to a separate room, and we'll let you watch it on television. And that caused a ruckus for 4 hours. So they're still, 1 year after the accident, the regulators in the Japanese government are still not getting the message that their role is not to promote, their role is to regulate. Mm-hmm.
And Maggie, continue.
I was just going to say, so people are asking legitimate questions, and they're asking it via petitions, via community meetings, via demonstrations, and they're asking the regulators to respond, and they're not responding.
Yeah, and the legitimate questions include, what is in my food?
Right, what is in my food? Is the air safe to breathe? Is the water safe to drink? I mean, they have contaminated rice. They have contaminated fish, contaminated beef, contaminated green tea. They have a lot of product that has been contaminated. And then the air is laced with hot particles that people can breathe in. And there's also fallout. Why don't you explain exactly how fallout works? Because I think that's an important part of this discussion.
Yep. And it's fallout of what?
Right.
Well, after the accident, when the accident first happened, in the first 3 or 4 or 5 days, lots of radioactive gases were released, things called xenon and krypton, and they're noble gases, and an enormous cloud was over the Fukushima prefecture, the state of Fukushima. That within 4 days that we were picking up that xenon and krypton in Seattle, at 40,000 times higher than what it normally is. So there was an enormous amount. Now people breathed that in and then exhaled it, and they were in a cloud surrounded by it. And it was also, it's fat soluble, so it enters their body. Then after that came the iodine. And that's not a gas, but it aerosolized and then entered kids' thyroids.
Yeah.
And they're finding now that 1/3 of the kids tested have lumps in their thyroids. 1/3 of them. And we're not even a year into the accident. The next thing that happened were heavier isotopes called cesium and strontium. And they fell to the ground. And what people are measuring with their little inspector detectors is predominantly the cesium that's on the ground, that's the fallout that's come down and is everywhere. Now it accumulates, water pushes it into trenches, and it accumulates on the side of the road. But it also shows up where kids play. I mean, kids like to kick through leaves, and now it's on their shoes and on their hands and in their lungs and
in their children's lungs where they play, lumps on their thyroid. And I ask a rhetorical question. Why is this information marginalized by the media? I mean, why are we not hearing this? Today, we can hear something, but there seems to be almost a conspiracy to marginalize people who will be concerned about this. And including the Japanese people, the mothers and fathers of the children who are so affected, and the children, I believe, are affected more quickly than older people.
There's a whole organization in Japan that's formed called Save the Children of Fukushima, and it's to protect the children who have been exposed and are receiving ongoing exposures. Why it's happening early in the accident, the U.S. government, under the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission downplayed the whole accident. I think there's some important facts that should come out here. First off, Hillary Clinton reached an agreement with the Prime Minister of Japan only a few weeks after the accident that the U.S. would not push aside Japanese imports, that we would continue to support the economy because they knew how devastating it was. Emails just came out, was it a month ago, that showed that the NRC, Nuclear Regulatory Commission of the United States, knew how bad the accident was 9 days before the people of Japan were warned and evacuated. And so the governments were playing with people's lives in an effort to maintain economies at full scale. So it's all about money. It's clearly about money. The utilities are playing a game about money, and the regulators are playing a game about money. In the U.S. and Canada, all the monitoring on the West Coast was shut down. And we have independent monitoring from different universities and different independent labs that show a tremendous amount of radiation came to the U.S. And yet our governments say, oh, we don't need to monitor anymore because there's nothing coming here. Mm-hmm. So it's
disgusting.
An example is that the FDA, we get millions of fish a year, and the FDA has sampled 186 of them for radiation. We're just not testing. It's on the, you know, if you don't know, it's not there. It's a very comfortable place to be. What you don't know can't hurt you.
It's like the ostrich putting your head in the sand and you don't see it, so there's no threat there.
Yeah. Now we're seeing this in there's a concerted effort within the nuclear community, and that's the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, the Japanese industry, the IAEA, and the people that produce nuclear power. Are deliberately downplaying the significance of low-level radiation. There's a worldwide push in those organizations that are controlled by the money that builds nuclear power plants to downplay the significance of the radiation that the people in Fukushima are receiving. The Frontline did a piece 3 weeks ago. 3 weeks ago, Frontline did a piece. And they had a Japanese scientist on saying that the people in Fukushima could get 20 millisieverts, and that was no problem. And the Frontline guy just bought it. It was Miles O'Brien. He just bought it and never questioned it.
When you say that people could get 20 millisieverts, it means that you could go in to the area or where and be exposed to 20 millisieverts, and you would have no health problem.
Right. Right, and that would come from the ground.
What does 20 millisieverts represent?
Well, I'll kick it over to the American system of REM. It's 2 REM, which is the equivalent of several pretty severe X-rays to your brain or something like that. And what we did on the site to try to say, one, it was just patently wrong, but we went to published reports that the National Academy of Science had out, and we showed that, in fact, the population in those zones, for every year they were in there, one out of every 500 people would get a cancer from that exposure that this guy said was no big deal. But it's more important than that. That was a blended average of old people and young people. And of course, you know, old people are gonna die from something else before they ever get a cancer. But children, and especially young girls, are 5 times more susceptible, and even 10 times more when they're very, very young. So the number really works out that for the kids in Fukushima, the chances of a cancer for every year they're in that town are 1 out of 20 to 1 out of 100. So essentially in one class of 20 kids, one of those kids is gonna get a cancer. And there's a lot of those that never came up and it used industry data. So that's an example of how the American press isn't asking the probing questions of the industry, and the industry is just overwhelming them with misinformation.
And at the same time, a whole country such as Germany has reacted to the Fukushima disaster by putting in place the plan to completely end nuclear power reactors in their country. And also France, there has been unrest and demonstrations in France, which is a premier nuclear power country. And also in Italy, they're going to phase out nuclear power reactors. But why the United States is far behind? And here in Vermont, where we have Energy Vermont Yankee now pushing the Vermont Public Service Board to extend the license for 20 more years, just to rubber stamp what the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has put in place for us. It seems as though everything is going on just as before. And as you say, it's terrible because we're not getting the accurate information, that even on a supposedly expose program such as Frontline, where they have the scientist saying that this dosage of 20 millisieverts is okay for children and for others. It's shocking. It is shocking and distressing.
Margaret, when I was on your program a few years ago, we talked about the German study that showed the increase in cancers surrounding plants in Germany. It was a German study.
Right.
And the doctor, Winfried Eisenberg, came to Fletcher Allen and spoke, and I got to hear him and meet him. And now, just 2 weeks ago, the French came out with a study in France that substantiates the German study, that shows that operating nuclear power plants give off constant emissions, and those emissions do cause cancers to the population living around the plant.
And especially early childhood cancers.
Yes, yes.
And it's the ratio increases as the child is moved closer to the nuclear power reactor. And that brings to mind Dr. Helen Caldicott's editorial in the New York Times in maybe April of 2011, after Fukushima, and she set forth the case against the radiation, you know, poisoning us from the nuclear reactors. And their answer was, somebody published a study called the Oxford Study, and about radiation and studying it in England, and their conclusion was that only children of rich people will get leukemia faster than people who are living near a nuclear power plant. That was the conclusion of that stupid study called the Oxford Study.
It was a bogus.
It was a bogus theory.
There's another two things real quick. Steve Wing, Dr. Steve Wing, who I really respect his work. He had a study that showed that there clearly were cancers after Three Mile Island, that the authorities used techniques to mask the cancers. But he just published another study, and it looks at the studies like the KIC study in Germany and the French study, and he basically says we're not getting all the data correctly, even in those, because we're looking at this broad population, and really the best way to look for cancers in a population is to look at the young people, not the broad population, because, you know, old people are going to die of something else before they're ever exposed. So Wing's got a study out, it's only a week or two old, that talks about if you're going to do it right, here's how you should structure a study. And in fact, all these numbers, like the KIC study and the thing in France, will in fact have higher numbers than the techniques that they're using. But the other thing is that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission clearly has not learned a lesson. Just yesterday, they published a study that if there's a severe accident in America, that everything will work just fine afterward, and the people will behave appropriately, and all the backup systems will work, and the chances of an American dying of a cancer from a nuclear accident are 1 in 1 billion. Now, there's not that many Americans, so they're basically saying if there's a nuclear accident in America, no one needs to worry. And that's just yesterday.
And the data produced by Dr. Wing and another recent study that Dr. Wing didn't do, but I can't remember the name of the scientist, did in post Three Mile Island accident. There are a lot of cancers and a lot of deaths. And as they're doing this, they're not talking about what's happening in terms of other health effects. Like the cesium that's absorbed, that's released and absorbed into children, that in Chernobyl, that caused a thing called Chernobyl heart, where the cesium is absorbed into the muscle in the body, just like potassium. And so the body sucks it right up, and it causes malformed hearts, and kids are quite ill and dying. And, you know, so there's many, many other illnesses that have been tracked to radiation exposures that are not even being considered in these studies. They're just talking about cancers.
And I'm afraid that the Japanese government and the Japanese medical establishment are going to try their very best to hide the numbers coming out of Fukushima Prefecture. You know, they'll already we've seen where national death rates have been published in Japan, they're not available in the areas near the Fukushima reactor. For whatever reason, that data is not available for the last 9 months. Why is that?
Yeah.
So I'm afraid that the medical community is gonna just follow the Japanese government and try to downplay the significance of this. But this time, we have the internet, and that's the difference. You know, our site and others have been really instrumental in finding ways for that information to get out that don't rely on mainstream media and that don't rely on governmental organizations. And that's what Maggie has done so well on, that's what makes our site special, I think, is that we try to crowdsource.
We try to get information. We're working with a number of scientists across the world. And so there's an international group. One of the groups that we're working with, for example, on the radiation testing he was talking about before is safecast.org. And Safecast is a crowdsourced team. And that team is amazing. They've taught all different normal people how to test for radiation and how to do appropriate samples. And scientists are working with them. And then they've charted all these measurements on maps. And you can go and see their website. And in the same way, Fairwinds has produced 50 videos talking about the different nuclear power plant issues across the country. And that's at fairwinds.com. And we will, in a few minutes, show a video for your viewers.
Okay.
And, you know, I know that you had originally planned for only a few more minutes, so I don't know if you want to continue that schedule.
I think that if you can say that we have touched upon major issues for the moment, which I find so disturbing, I can't even articulate how disturbed I feel about the things that you have told me and are public now. And the thing is that this whole nuclear power reactor industry is chugging along. There are new power reactors that are planned in Georgia and in South Carolina, those two states, and all of and again, we have to be aware that it is taxpayers' money that is doing this, and all of the political talk about too much government and everything like that. We the people are the government. We are the people who are funding all the research and development, including the research and development that Bill Gates is doing for the new uranium nuclear power reactors that he's handing over to China.
Yeah, that's a terribly frightening issue, and I'm so disappointed in Bill Gates.
Yes, Bill Gates, we are very disappointed in you, and it's a horrible thing because you can have all of the commercials in the world, and they are commercials, about how you're giving free books away to people. But meanwhile, you're promoting this horrible, horrendous industry and the uranium mining in Australia, which was just opened up recently again. And Maggie, speak to about the Bill Gates thing for just a few minutes. And
Arnie has done a tremendous job, and it would be enough for a whole show if you'd like us to come back.
Okay, I hope
to talk about the new reactors. And he's done a lot on the AP1000 and other designs and their lack of safety. So if you'd like us to come back on that subject, he has testified to the NRC. We've done several videos on that. And you're right, it's our tax dollars that's underwriting that infrastructure.
Yes.
Let me just say one thing on that. I testified on this on these reactors down south, and I said they weren't safe. And one of the Georgia legislators basically said, you know, he's a Yankee. What does he know? You know, this is our decision whether it's safe or not. You know, just go home, Yankee. And I'm fine with that, except they want my loan guarantee.
Right.
So as a Yankee, they want me to guarantee their money. But as a Yankee, they don't want me to say, I question the safety. Yeah. Can't have it both ways. You know, the fact is, if you want to build a nuke in Georgia, don't ask me for a loan guarantee.
Right. Yeah. And our son, our nephew lives in Georgia, and our daughter lives in South Carolina. So, yes, we do have family connections and real concerns as well.
Yeah.
But we're happy to come back on that. Okay. And I guess in our closing, I'd like to invite any viewers that look at this video, if they have questions, please contact us. The contact information is on the website, fairwinds.com. And we're in the process of revamping the website. We got a grant to revamp it and make it more user-friendly and have more topics up there of an educational nature.
Oh, thank you very much, Maggie Gunderson.
You're welcome.
Arnie Gunderson, and please come back.
We would love to.
Month.
Thank you for
thank
having
you.
Us.
And now, thank you, viewers, for watching this, and take your information and do something with it. And now we'll go to the video from Fairwinds Energy Education.
Thank
you.
You.
Hi, I'm Arnie Gunderson from Fairwinds. Today, I'd like to introduce a video by Ian Goddard. But before I do that, I want to talk about beer. Now, that's not the stuff you drink, but it's B-E-I-R. And it stands for the Biological Effects of Ionizing Radiation. And it's a report from the National Academy of Sciences. What got me thinking about this were two disturbing news stories out of Japan. The first story comes from NHK, which is the major Japanese radio television station. And the story reports that in Fukushima Prefecture, very, very high levels of radioactive cesium has been found in male cedar flowers. That's the tip of the cedar, apparently is loaded with cesium. The data indicates that it's about 250,000 disintegrations per second in a kilogram of these cedar flowers. Now, that's pretty serious because, of course, in the spring, the flowers will bud, and that radioactive cesium will go airborne again. Now, what got my attention, though, was the Japanese response to that. And here's what NHK said. The agency reports this is not a great health hazard, as it is only about 10 times what a person would be exposed to from normal background in Tokyo. Now, there's all sorts of assumptions that go into that calculation, but to my mind, when you release 250,000 disintegrations per second of cesium into the air when the flowers burst, that should get public health attention. The second story is also from Japan, and this one from Japan Times, where radioactive grasshoppers have been detected in Fukushima Prefecture. Now, the grasshoppers are contaminated to the tune of 4,000 disintegrations per second in a kilogram of grasshoppers. Now, why is this important? The Japanese eat radioactive grasshoppers with their beer. Now, the story goes on to say this. The scientists think it's safe to eat the bugs because they're usually in snack-sized portions, crunchy soy-marinated locusts, enjoyed with a cold mug of beer. Now, I think drinking beer is fine, but when the bug you're eating has 4,000 disintegrations per second of cesium, that should be a concern to public health officials. That gets me to the issue of beer, biological effects of ionizing radiation. The beer report shows that radiation exposure and cancer rate are linear. What that means is it's proportional. The more radiation you get, the more cancer you're likely to get. The less cancers come from lower doses. So if this dose and this is cancer, the line goes up and down in a straight line. That's what beer says. It's called the LNT, linear no threshold approach. And what that means in beer is this.
If somebody's exposed to 100 rem, that's 1 sievert, the chances of getting cancer are 1 in 10. If you cut that in 10, so if somebody gets 10 rem, that's 100 millisieverts, the chances of getting cancer are 1 in 100. Going down one more, if you get 1 rem of radiation, or about 10 millisieverts, the chances of a cancer are about 1 in 1,000. Now in Japan, the Japanese government is allowing people to go back into these radiation zones when the radiation exposure is 2 rem. What that means is that they're willing to say that your chance of getting cancer are 1 in 500 if you go back into these areas that are presently off limits, and the exposure levels are 2 rem or 20 millisieverts in a year. But it's worse than that. The number that we're using in the Beer report is for the entire population, old people and young. And old people are going to die of something else before cancer gets to them, whereas young people have rapidly dividing cells and they live a longer time, so they're more likely to get cancer. So if you go into the Beer report and you look at table 12D, you'll see that young women have 5 times that number chance of getting cancer than the population as a whole. So young girls in the Fukushima prefecture are going to get 5 times the exposure they would get from 2 rem. That means about 1 in 100 young girls is going to get cancer as a result of the exposure in Fukushima prefecture. And that's for every year they're in that radiation zone. If you're in there for 5 years, it's 5 out of 100 young girls will get cancer. Now, the Beer report only addresses cancer, and of course there's other effects of radiation that are not included in Beer, so it's actually worse than that. Two more items. The first is that the Beer report does not address hot particles. Now, we've been over that extensively on the site, and you'll see that imbibing it, a kid gets radioactive cesium on their hands and they swallow it, or breathing it in is not included in the Beer report. And the last piece brings us over to Ian Goddard's video. And that's this assumption by the Japanese and the International Atomic Energy Agency that at some point this radiation is really so hard to measure it doesn't count anymore. Well, the data indicates that just the opposite is happening. And that brings me to Ian Goddard's video. I'll be back at the end of the video to try to summarize everything we've talked about today.
Following the Fukushima nuclear disaster, the Japanese government raised the level of allowable radiation exposure from 1 to 20 millisieverts per year, even for children.
On April 19th, the Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology announced that the amount of radiation a child can be exposed to in 1 year is 20 millisieverts.
Officials proclaim that 20 millisieverts per year is safe, but is it? In this video, we'll test the official claim of safety against established radiobiological science, the same science upon which the United States National Academy of Sciences predicts that 20 millisieverts of radiation will not only cause cancers all across Fukushima, but will primarily kill women and children. In this video, we'll also test the official claim of safety against recently published research, such as the largest study of nuclear workers ever conducted, comprising over 400,000 workers from 15 countries. The study found increased cancer mortality among nuclear workers exposed to an average of 2 millisieverts per year. That's just 1/10 of the allegedly safe 20 millisieverts per year allowed in Fukushima. In this video, we'll see that the public is being misled by governments and major media into a false sense of safety regarding nuclear fallout, obstructing the ability of citizens to be fully informed, so that we can make sound decisions that direct our democracies to safe energy futures. So stay tuned as we cover all that and more. The United States National Academy of Sciences is a logical resource to consult about the state of radiation science. And the Academy regularly publishes reports on low-dose radiation risks. The reports are based on decades of epidemiological and radiobiological research, from which risk-predicting models are built. The Academy's most recent report provides both raw data and instructions so that you can apply their risk models to a wide range of exposure scenarios. We can therefore find the cancer risk of 20 millisieverts. This is the Academy's data table for estimated cancer cases caused by 100 millisieverts of radiation, stratified by age and segregated by sex. Highlighted in yellow are the predicted number of cases for all cancers per 100,000 persons. Immediately, we can see that the risk of cancer uniformly decreases as age increases for both males and females. In other words, children are most vulnerable to radiation. Plotting these data yields this graph. This cancer risk graph keeps the shape irrespective of its dose. This shape is therefore the face of radiation-induced cancer risk across the human lifespan. Following the Academy's instructions on scaling the model to specific doses, the y-axis is recalibrated to the predicted cancer cases caused by the allegedly safe 20 millisieverts. And here in turn are recalibrations for 10 and for 2 millisieverts. According to the Academy, there is no harmless dose of radiation. So, obviously 20 millisieverts is not safe. But what's most remarkable is that children, and most especially girls, are the most at risk of radiation-induced cancer. In fact, girls are almost twice as vulnerable as same-aged boys. And a 5-year-old girl is 5 times, and an infant female 7 times, more vulnerable than a 30-year-old man. These data from the National Academy of Sciences are freely available to all major media and government officials. Yet rather than informing the public of the actual state of radiation science and the real risks of nuclear power, they lead us instead to believe that 20 millisieverts of radiation is either safe or its effects are a complete mystery.
Residents traveled to Tokyo to protest after the government loosened safety limits, despite the fact that the long-term impact of low-dose radiation is unknown. The long-term impact of low-dose radiation is unknown.
Even worse than a failure to inform, major media lead the public to believe that scientific models of low-dose radiation risk, such as we've just reviewed, don't even exist. Yet outside the media's cocoon of blissful ignorance, science marches forward, further characterizing the risks of low-dose radiation. And the flow of incoming evidence, published since the Academy's last report in 2006, suggests that the Academy's risk model is either accurate or may underestimate risk. In 2007, the largest study ever conducted on occupational low-dose radiation exposure was published. The study contained over 400,000 nuclear industry workers from 15 countries. The study found a significant relation between radiation dose and cancer mortality. The average period of nuclear worker employment in the study was 10.5 years, and the average dose accumulated over those years was 19.4 millisieverts. This implies an average annual dose of 1.85 millisieverts per year. To get a more accurate estimate of the average annual dose, this data table, showing the average cumulative dose and years of employment for each country, is useful. From these data, we find that the average annual dose for the whole cohort was 1.95 millisieverts per year, rounding off to 2 millisieverts per year. The data provided by the study also allow calculation of the median annual dose of the whole cohort, which was lower still, at merely 0.45 or 1/2 of a millisievert per year. So the representative dose rate among the nuclear workers in the study was at most 1/10 of the 20 millisieverts per year allowed in Fukushima. So with an allowance of 20 millisieverts per year, Fukushiman children may receive up to 10 times the dose rate associated with increased cancer among adult nuclear workers. To get a sense of the distribution of exposures over the cohort, 90% of the workers in the study received cumulative doses under 50 millisieverts over their entire period of employment, which overall was 10.5 years on average. So dividing 50 millisieverts by 10.5 years suggests that the dose rate for most of the workers was probably below 5 millisieverts per year, which is just 1/4 of the maximum annual dose for Fukushimans. To get a sense of the distribution of the radiation effect over the 15-country cohort, the authors eliminated each country from the study one at a time to see if eliminating one country's data eliminated the indicated radiation effect. In each sub-analysis, they found that the excess risk ratio, or ERR, was higher than, but compatible with, the National Academy of Sciences BIR-7 risk model, which was the risk model we previously reviewed. So the indicated radiation effect was not biased by data from any particular country. The authors of the study noted that worker smoking is a possible confounding factor, since lung cancer was common among the workers. However, other smoking-associated cancers showed little relation to radiation dose, and the authors concluded that even if smoking played a role, it cannot fully account for the dose relation of cancer to radiation. So let's recap. The 15-country study, authored by 51 radiation scientists, is the largest study ever conducted of nuclear workers. It found increased cancer risk among the workers. The average worker dose was 2 millisieverts per year. Most workers received under 5 millisieverts per year. And the maximum dose allowed in Japan is 20 millisieverts per year. That's 10 times higher than the average annual worker dose and 4 times higher than most worker doses. Two years later, in 2009, Jacob and colleagues analyzed the 15-country study we just reviewed, plus 8 other nuclear worker studies. What makes nuclear worker exposure especially relevant to areas contaminated by nuclear fallout is that both exposure scenarios deliver doses at a slow, persistent rate. And the meta-analysis of Jacob and colleagues suggests that such slow dose rates might be more harmful than fast dose rates. For example, this chart from Jacob et al. Shows excess cancer mortality risk found in 9 studies of nuclear workers. Each study is denoted by a red dot whose rightward displacement from zero risk along the bottom axis denotes the degree of increased risk found in that study. In contrast, the blue dots represent the comparative excess risk among the atom bomb survivor cohort, adjusted to match the sex ratio and average age of the nuclear workers in each study. As we can see, the red dots are usually more rightward displaced than the blue dots, and therefore, most nuclear worker studies found a higher risk of cancer mortality than among atom bomb survivors. This is a significant finding because radiation risk models are largely founded upon fast dose exposures, like from the atomic bomb blasts, and it has been assumed that fast dose rates were more harmful. However, the findings of Jacob and colleagues brings this view into question. As an editorial on the findings of Jacob et al. In the journal Occupation and Environmental Medicine observed, quote, "A number of recent studies challenge the assumption that low dose rate exposures to penetrating forms of ionizing radiation are less effective at causing cancer than high dose rate exposures, because risk estimates for people who received low dose rate exposures tend to be larger than or similar to the corresponding estimates derived from the study of Japanese atomic bomb survivors." End of quote. This graph from Jacob et al. Demonstrates the discrepancy of risk models. The two leading risk models are on the left. The second is the National Academy of Sciences cancer risk model we examined previously. Both risk models are based largely on the fast dose rate exposure experienced by atomic bomb survivors. But the third bar on the right represents the higher level of risk derived from the slow dose rate experienced by nuclear workers. So the cutting edge of meta-analytical research suggests that the leading contemporary radiation risk models may actually underestimate the carcinogenic efficiency of low-dose radiation. Science is not only further clarifying the harmful effects of low-dose radiation on large-scale macroscopic levels, but on the microscopic level as well. Recent research has increased the fidelity of data in the low-dose range regarding radiation-induced genetic damage. Chromosomal translocations are a form of genetic damage resulting from the faulty repair of DNA molecules damaged by genotoxic chemicals or radiation. Chromosomal translocations, also known as chromosomal aberrations, are believed to result in many forms of cancer, and an increased frequency of chromosomal aberrations is recognized as an indication of an increased risk of cancer. As such, radiation-induced chromosomal aberrations are fundamental to the causal mechanism of radiation-induced cancer. It has been well documented that medium to high dose radiation increases chromosomal aberrations, but the influence of low dose radiation has been less certain. But if this mechanism of radiation-induced cancer occurs at low doses, there would be little reason to doubt that low dose radiation can cause cancer. In 2010, Bhatti and colleagues published a meta-analysis of studies that examined the influence of medical X-ray examinations on the incidence of chromosomal translocations. They sought to gain greater precision on the impact of low-dose radiation by pooling data from multiple studies. Not only did they find a dose response in the low-dose range, but to their surprise, the frequency of chromosomal aberrations per unit of radiation increased below approximately 20 millisieverts. Moreover, at doses below approximately 10 millisieverts, the frequency of aberrations per unit of radiation increased further still, and by an order of magnitude. Given these findings, evidence for the carcinogenicity of radiation at low doses could hardly be more logically indicated. Let's examine this formally. The hypothetical syllogism is a two-premise argument schema of classical logic of the form given that, if it's the case that P, then Q, and if it's the case that Q, then R, then we may conclude that it's also the case that if P, then R. Plugging the scientific evidence we've just reviewed into the hypothetical syllogism, we may reason as follows. Given that, if there's low-dose radiation, then there's more chromosomal harm. And if there's more chromosomal harm, then there's more cancer. Then we may conclude that if there's low-dose radiation, then there's more cancer. To some degree, this syllogism may be an oversimplification. However, our inputs in this valid argument schema are the outputs of state-of-the-art biological research. In this video, we've reviewed both established radiobiology and recent radiobiological research. From this broad scientific base, we've observed that the National Academy of Sciences predicts increased cancer risk from exposures below 20 millisieverts per year. Research published since the Academy's last report in 2006 corroborates that prediction. Recent research also suggests that the Academy's risk model may underestimate cancer risk. Recent research also finds that radiation exposures below 20 millisieverts are associated with genetic damage. Therefore, both historical and cutting-edge scientific research consistently demonstrate that Japan's allowance of 20 millisieverts per year is not safe.
Well, I'd like to thank Ian Goddard for that excellent analysis and kind of sum up what all this means. According to the National Academy of Sciences, the BEER report, Biological Effect of Ionizing Radiation, the chance of someone in Fukushima receiving a cancer is about 1 in 500 at the threshold that the Japanese have set. But it's worse than that. Young girls are 5 times more radiosensitive than the data indicates. So what that means is that at least 1 in 100 young girls is likely to get cancer if they go back in under those radiation limits. And that doesn't include hot particles, and it doesn't include what Mr. Goddard has clearly shown is a problem of low-level exposures perhaps being worse than linear. Well, thank you very much, and I'll keep you informed.